particular picture. We know that, okay, this from last 50 more than 50 years, or we can say several decades, this microelectronics has played a very important role in semiconductor industry and in our daily lives. So in all fields, we can say in medical, education, personal size TV, portable devices, cell phones and laptops, in communication, etc. So this the main demand for this one, because as we scale our transistor size, so suppose if we go by this x-axis, we can see as the number of years are increasing from 1970 to 2020. At the same time, our scaling of transistor is going at lower technology nodes. Suppose earlier it was in micron, suppose 1 micron, and then it went up to, in 2010, it went up to 32 nanometer, and in finally 2020, we have reached around 3 to 5 nanometer range. So if you see with respect to the number of years and this feature size, at the same time, this this CPU transistor count is also doubling every 2 years. That is the same formula by Moore's law, given like the area, which is like scaling by 0.7 times, 0.7 into 0.7, roughly we can say 50%. Like area is reducing, and the area is reducing, and we are able to integrate more devices in the same area, and that's why we can say, okay, transistors are doubling. And the main reason for this rapid demand of this MOSFET in the microelectronics industry is due to this small size, because the size is roughly in the nanometer range, and the cost is also very low, and power consumption is very low, and reliability is very good. So that's why this particular MOSFET is preferred in semiconductor IC industry. So, but when we talk about the MOSFET, there are several challenges with MOSFET. It comes, so while we have like the packing density, like 100.8 billion transistors per square millimeter, we can fit this much of count of transistor in this size in 10 nanometer process node. So it means we have sufficient number of transistors. As we scale down, this number of transistors can go increase, and it also improves the speed. So suppose for the same 10 nanometer, we are getting the clock frequency roughly in 5 to 6 gigahertz range, so which is very good, and power consumption is very less, and wafer cost is like $100 to $500, we can say, for a single wafer. But when we scale our transistor, at the same time we found some difficulties. The most important one, which everyone is aware, like short channel effect. So in short channel effects, it comes like substrate leakage current, drain induced barrier lowering, velocity saturation, and VTH roll off, where this substrate leakage current is mainly due to this gate. When we apply the gate 0 volt, and there is a drain voltage, there will be some current flowing from drain to source that we consider as a substrate current. And DIBL, suppose for long channel device where VDS is zero, we are getting good behavior, but due to this short channel effect, this our peak, basically it is reducing, so it is impacted by our DIBL. And to improve this thing, so there were several solutions like SOI based MOSFET were introduced, and junctionless transistor, multi-gate technology to increase drain current, or we can say gate electrostatic controllability. So these things were introduced to cover these short channel effect parameter. So, but when we talk about these three things, so at the same time, it comes with this substrate slope of 60 millivolt per decade, which is a physical challenge for MOSFET. So we cannot go further below this one. So it sees several challenges with this substrate slope. So in that, so to avoid this limit, we need to go with some other devices, cases where this emerging fields comes into picture. So in that possible solution, we can say we can go with some steep substrate kind of devices, which is nothing but tunnel field effect transistors. So these are the some several challenges with MOSFET, which motivates to search for other FETs to go with other options. And if we go, if you see for different kind of a structure, we have like a single gate structure, double gate, and then we have triple gate, like a three-side gate, and then we have quadruple gate and pi gate structure. So these are used to improve our gate electrostatic controllability, or we can say like where we want to improve our drain current, that these different architectures are used. But when we talk about this MOSFET thing, where this MOSFET is having short channel length and where the this junctions are sharply defined between source and drain regions and channels are needed, so there are several things like ultra fast annealing techniques are needed for this MOSFET, and novel doping techniques are needed. So these cost too much in case of MOSFET. So if we go for a junctionless transistor, so what the cost we are adding through this thermal annealing or ultra fast annealing methods, that we can save with a junctionless transistor. So this was the main motivation to use junctionless transistor, which is nothing but called as a gated resistor. And this junctionless transistor was proposed in 2009, and this was published in Nature in NOR transistor without junction by J.P. Colling. So if you see for junctionless transistor, we have like this is analogy. We can see like we have a gate, we have gate controllability, and we can simply consider that we are applying voltage at gate of junctionless transistor, and it is similar to like pressure we are applying through this notch, and then basically the current will flow through this pipe, like water is flowing through this pipe. So the structure is similar to like this one. So where we have like a channel, we can say in between channel, this is completely nanowire, we can say, where this is drain, this is source, and in between there is a channel, and then this is gate, and we can say that okay, for n type this is this silicon nanowire will be completely n type doped, and for p type junctionless it will be completely p type. So it depends on which type of junctionless we are saying. So how it differentiates with respect to simple MOSFET. So in MOSFET case, we have the structure like source, then channel, then drain, n plus p, n plus type structure, where p and junctions are there between two regions, source channel or channel drain, we can say. But here in case of junctionless, we have uniform. So there is no junctions. Basically, we say n plus n plus n plus type. So this is like without junction, we say. So the doping wise, this source, drain, and channel will be similar type. And yeah, so this is a basic difference between our inversion mode MOSFET and this junctionless MOSFET. And now, how this device structure looks like, if you see for this inversion mode MOSFET, we have suppose buried oxide, we have source and drain N plus and gate structure, and we have for junctionless. So the main difference between these two devices are that junctionless transistor, this works based on the accumulation mode, and while our conventional or inversion mode MOSFET works based on the inversion phenomena. So there are basic differences like in the on state and off state condition. So this in on state, inversion mode MOSFET works basically on this surface inversion current phenomena in high electric field, while junctionless works based on the bulk conduction current in low electric field. And in off state, it basically works in surface threshold current in low electric field and body threshold current with respect to high electric field. So these are the basic difference between this inversion mode and junctionless MOSFET. And then we say that okay, there are several kind of structure for junctionless. We can say triple gate, multi gate FET. Then multi-gate, in case of multi-gate gate electrode, we can say it is wrapped around a silicon wire, which is called finger or fin, which is forming a gate structure that derives optimal control of channel potential. So this is the basic difference. And then how, when we are going to design junctionless transistor, then basically we need to know that how it, this device works in off condition and in on condition. So when device is in off state, the conduction is blocked by the full depletion of the fin, which is caused by the gate and silicon film work function difference. And the cross section of silicon film should be small in case of when we want to make our junctionless transistor off, so that maximum depletion can be done in that cross section area, so that device can be fully turned off and there will be a small leakage. So these are the two things when we go for designing any junctionless transistor we keep in mind. And to achieve good on state current, high on state current, we need habit doping to allow a reasonable amount of current flow. So roughly when we say that how much range we can consider for channel doping, so it is considered in the range of 10^19 to 10^20 per centimeter cube. And the gate work function, which is roughly considered from 5 to 5.5 electron volt for NMOS case. So this is the structure where we have buried oxide, and then we have simple, we can say nanowire, this yellow structure, and then we have like a gate. Gate is present, and we have a green small portion, which is nothing but oxide. So why we need this buried layer? So basically buried is used to create a Schottky junction at bottom of silicon device layer. So generally it is used kind of platinum silicide materials roughly, which is having a work function of 0.87 electron volt. So this is like 2D view, how it looks like buried oxide and plus silicon, and then oxide, and then gate it has. And these are the parameters which is generally used when we are going to design a junctionless transistor. So now when we talk about device operation for VG less than VTH condition, basically there is a potential barrier exist, we can say, between source and channel. And electron flows through diffusion to the drain side. And while in case of VG greater than VTH, we can say there are no potential barrier. Basically, it is flat. Here, if we can see, there are some barrier exist in this case, while in this case, it is almost flat. So when we apply a drain bias, in that case, the current flows due to drift of carrier. So how then threshold voltage, basically we calculate in junctionless transistor. So threshold voltage in junctionless is nothing but gate voltage at which drift and diffusion component of drain currents have equal magnitude. So these are for VG less than VTH and VG greater than VTH condition. And now when we talk about again SOI based MOSFET fabrication steps, so these are the steps: isolation we need, then n-type implant plus activation, source drain contact formation. And also in MOSFET case, we need extra steps like all immediate implants, which is extension plus source drain side, and thermal annealing we need for activating the above implants, gate dielectric deposition and gate stack deposition, gate patterning. These steps are needed in case of MOSFET, while in case of junctionless transistor, these two steps we can avoid. So generally, these two steps are not needed. So we can say we are saving a number of fabrication steps in junctionless case. So basically, thermal annealing, we can say this is process used in device fabrication, which involves heating a single wafer to affect its electrical properties. And when we want that, okay, wafer can be heated to activate dopants and change film to film or film to wafer substrate interfaces, in that case we need this thermal annealing process. Also in junctionless transistor, this gate doesn't see high thermal budget, so we can easily integrate high K where we want to improve our controllability, or we can go with multi-gate options. So these things we can cover in junctionless transistor. And now, so when we talk about the properties of this particular device, so we have different kind of properties like intrinsic device delay, we have where for which is defined with ratio of CB by I. So here for inversion mode MOSFET, we have the relation with L square divided by mu into VDD. So it doesn't depend on the doping concentration in inversion mode MOSFET case, while in case of junctionless, because the ID current is directly proportional to this doping concentration. So when this doping concentration increases, so overall we can say this intrinsic device delay got reduced. So from here, this particular figure we can see for MOSFET, which is a solid dotted line, it is having kind of intrinsic delay in range of 10 power minus 1 picosecond. While if we increase the doping concentration in junctionless case, we see that from 1 into 10 power 19 to 8 into 10 power 19. So this black dotted one, it shows that, okay, as we increase the doping concentration, so our device intrinsic delay got reduced due to this relationship. So these are, so we can say, okay, so in terms of device delay, this junctionless is purely dependent, mostly dependent on this doping part, because these parameters roughly are fixed COX, which is derived from process technology node. This L is again, this is fixed. And mobility, suppose this is also a fixed, temperature is fixed. So how we can, what parameter we can vary? We can vary this doping concentration, which is either it can be acceptor type or N type or donor type. And when we talk about another performance parameter, so there is a mobility degradation. So with respect to inversion mode MOSFET, if we can see in inversion mode MOSFET, so the mobility decreases from undoped to doped roughly 35.4%, while in case of junctionless, the mobility degradation is only 16.5%. So this is the major thing. So it plays an important role, this mobility degradation in transconductance, where we want to achieve higher gain, because the gain is directly proportional to transconductance of transistor, and transconductance is also defined with respect to this mobility. So if you see here in this particular figure, where we have transconductance characteristic of both junctionless TriGate and inversion mode MOSFET, because in inversion mode MOSFET case, if you see from this particular figure, so suppose initially the device was off and then it goes to the linear region, or we can say triode region, and then it moved to saturation region in the peak, and then from saturation again it is started to linear. So then it goes from saturation to linear region. In that case, in inversion mode MOSFET, this due to huge reduction in the mobility, overall transconductance, we can say it is rapidly decreasing, while in case of junctionless, it is slightly reducing because mobility degradation in junctionless case is small. So this is the behavior of transconductance. So we can say where at higher gate voltage, we need a higher gain. So we can go with this particular device because it has higher transconductance at higher gate voltages also. So when we talk about the CMOS standards versus junctionless, so for high performance devices where we talk about ID set and I off, so generally for 25 nanometer gate length, so this junctionless transistor is having the ID set current in the range similar to high performance this MOS device, while off state current, when we compare with respect to high performance CMOS device, it is having less. So overall, we can say the I on by I of ratio of junctionless transistor is improved compared to this high performance CMOS standards. So this is the one thing. So where we want to go with a lower I off current, suppose we want to go for switching applications in digital circuits, so we can go with the junctionless transistor after looking this particular waveform. Now, if you see about this picture, from this picture, we have different structures, single gate, double gate, and triple, and gate all around. So here the doping profile for single gate, double and triple and all around gate. So AG is generally considered as all around gate structure where we have different doping concentration. And if you see, as we increase the gate, then at the same time, ion by IF ratio, we are improving. As the gate controllability is increasing, so in that case, ion by IF ratio got improved. And DIBL generally we calculate, if you want to calculate with respect to millivolt only, this is nothing but threshold voltage at two different drain to source voltage. So based on that, if we calculate, so roughly for this gate all around the structure, it comes in the range of 46 millivolt per volt. And such result slope also, it is closer to our physical limit, which is 60 millivolt per decade. So now when we talk about the application part, so how we can design from junctionless transistor to any digital circuit. Suppose just we want to design a inverter, we can take a silicon N-type structure and silicon P-type structure, and we can connect both P-plus poly, this gate, and N-plus poly, we can sort, and we can apply input here, and output we can take on the sorted node of this output. So if we have two junctionless transistor of NNP type, and then we can combine in a simple format, and then basically we can make an inverter logic. And if you see from this ideal, so this green one is nothing but ideal characteristic, and for same we can say for MOSFET case, we have like for 22 nanometer high performance MOSFET, this black one. And for gate length of same 20 nanometer, we have junctionless transistor, which is again this bluish color. So if you see in terms of slope, if you see here, the slope of this particular device, MOSFET is poor compared to junctionless transistor. So we can say that, okay, this has better performance, junctionless transistor has better performance compared to this black dotted MOSFET structure. So for digital circuit application, as we have already seen, right, in off state condition, so the IOF is very low for this junctionless transistor. So overall, ion by IOF ratio is improving. So for switching application where we want to go from 1 to 0 or 0 to 1 mode, we can go with this kind of device, junctionless one. So now when we talk about junctionless, this has several advantages, like it has simpler fabrication process flow, it can save thermal annealing and extra source drain side diffusion where we want. And so overall fabrication cost, it reduces DIBL and ideal subthreshold slope, and less degradation of mobility compared to inversion mode MOSFET. It has lower gate cap and improved ion by IF ratio. So how this lower gate cap it has, because it is having the structure of accumulation, and because channel is buried in center of nanowire and series association of COX with depletion caps, so due to the series association with oxide capacitance, it decreases overall gate cap. And we have already discussed this ion by IF ratio in junctionless is higher. So what are the limitations with the junctionless device? Due to randomness and discrete nature of dopant atoms, it had random doping fluctuations, which is more in a small volume of transistor. And it also has low source drain contact resistance, and different gate materials are required for NMOS and PMOS devices. So these are the limitations. And now coming into the summary part, so this device has full CMOS functionality with advantage of no junction or doping gradients. And this device exhibits excellent turn off, because in a small cross-section area, we can fully deplete the channel part. And it has short channel characteristic, less short channel characteristic. And this is good candidate for future generation CMOS technologies where we want to replace our MOSFET. But when we talk about this junctionless transistor, because in junctionless case, it has high channel doping in the order of 10.19. So it also has some several challenges that, it leads to variability in parameters, which results in random doping fluctuations in nanometer region. So then we need to thought different kind of FETs, like a tunnel FET, where we want to address these issues and where we want to get a stiff subresolved slope devices. So we by using this particular device, tunnel field effect transistor, we can go to achieve subresolved slope below 60 millivolt per decade. And the main benefit with this particular device is it can work at lower supply voltage also, and it can provide low leakage current, and which leads to reduction in power consumption. So this motivates us that we can go where we want to avoid this high doping part. We can go with other FET kind of structure like a tunnel field effect transistor. So now when we talk about this tunnel field effect transistor, we have like a P plus source, an intrinsic channel, and N plus drain. Similarly, like it is a PIN structure, and this is nothing but non-local band-to-band tunneling mechanism. It works based on that one Jenner effect, we generally say. And this, the conduction mechanism in this FET is different from inversion mode MOS, and it requires low operating voltage. And its mechanism is governed by Jenner tunneling phenomena rather than injection of charge carrier. Generally, we say in case of inversion mode, this is a drift diffusion phenomena. So while in case of tunnel field effect transistor, so band-to-band tunneling phenomena happens. So basically, the mechanism in both kind of devices, it is different. And it has, like, it can turn on and off with an steep subthreshold slope, lower than 60 millivolt per decade at 300 Kelvin, we can say. So when we talk about this tunnel FET, why it is better than MOSFET?
Registration link mein bhejta hu.
Sorry. So here, if you can see from this particular picture, this is ideal switch characteristic where we are going from off to on state. And for this MOSFET, this black one, this is having a slightly poor characteristic from off to on state compared to this T-FET switch. And when we talk about this physical limit of 60 millivolt per decade, or which is defined by KT by Q LN10, so it limits further reduction in supply voltage for MOSFET case. As we scale down, so further scaling for supply is very difficult. And at the same time, the I off also got increased due to scaling, and it increases the power consumption. While in case of T-FET, since this subthreshold slope is below 60 millivolt per decade, it enables further
Dr. Sunil Pandey, sir, your mic is muted.
Yeah, his mic is muted.
In off state condition, generally we say that there is. Hello? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir,
you can continue.
Yeah. Okay. So in case of T-FET, when we talk about the working mechanism, so in off state condition, there is no accumulation of electron in intrinsic region, so which doesn't allow the tunneling of electron across the barrier due to presence of higher potential barrier. So as we can say that, as the gate bias, when increases, accumulation of electron is happened in the intrinsic region. So Then when we apply sufficient gate bias voltage, then band-to-band tunneling takes place, or we can say bearish tunneling. Suppose from P-plus source region is aligned with conduction band of intrinsic region, and when positive voltage at gate is not only responsible to turn on the device, but also it helps to reduce the potential barrier. And there is no empty state in the channel of conduction band, so that electron can easily tunnel from valence band of source into conduction band of channel. So there is a band overlapping from source to channel side for main conduction. So in T-FET case. And when we talk about this advantages of tunnel FET, so it has several advantages. It is like pin gated structure, which provides better scalability and steepness. And conduction is in a small tunneling region, and such result slope is below 60 millivolt per decade. And scaling is possible for supply voltage, and also because of this lower VDD, we can go at lower technology node, so which reduces the off state current, and we can say it increases overall IN by I of ratio. And as the supply is reduced, so overall reduces the static power dissipation also, and it is immune to short channel effect, and low temperature process is also possible in this case. While comparing with MOSFET, it has like in main working mechanism, MOSFET is working on drift diffusion phenomena or thermionic emission, while it is working based on the tunneling. So roughly we are getting the MOSFET current in 10⁻³ ampere per micrometer, while in case of T-FET, the current range is small. So that's why we are saying where we want to go for low voltage application, there only we can use this kind of device. But where we want to go for higher current capable device, generally this particular device has limitations. When we compare the IN by IF ratio, so it is in 10⁴, while in T-FET it is roughly in 10⁻⁙. And static power, we can say 10 microwatt, while in case of 0.1 femtowatt, so we are saving most powers in T-FET case due to supply scaling, and this is having some short channel effect while it is immune from this short channel effect. So in this case, thermionic emission, this is going through over the barrier. So from conduction band, electron is going. Suppose in off state condition, it needs to go through over the barrier, while in case of T-FET, this is directly going through the barrier. That is band to band tunneling, we can say, from valence band to conduction band region. So this is basic structure of T-FET, where this is a kind of source P plus body and intrinsic PIN kind of structure. And it is closer to the MOSFET, but with different important switching mechanism it has. And this device works based on the quantum mechanics rather than drift diffusion. So when we talk about this quantum mechanical tunneling, so suppose this is a ball which is going through this particular barrier, so it needs some kinetic energy more than this potential energy to pass through over the barrier. But in case of band-to-band tunneling, it doesn't need that much of kinetic energy. Kinetic energy can be lower than the required potential energy of this particular bell, and easily this ball can roll over through the barrier. So this is the basic difference between this classical mechanics and quantum mechanics. And this quantum mechanics is derived based on the Schrodinger equation when the particle is moving from region 1, 2, and 3. And based on this Schrodinger equation, we can calculate finite probability of tunneling through the barrier. So here, if you can see from Schrodinger equation, this is like a wave which is going from one region to other region. Suppose it is having kind of sinusoidal waveform, and when it is moving from this region to second region, so because the energy of this particular signal is reduced, so that's why the amplitude is also going reduced after when it is passing through these particular regions. And because due to this nature of wave, so this Schrodinger equations are used to derive the probability. So here, based on wave function we can derive through differential equation, we can get some differential equation solutions, and we can get these constant, and finally transmission probability, we can use this formula to calculate what is the probability to go from this region to this region. So for p-type T-fed, the hole enters the channel through the source and leaves the channel through the drain. This is the condition Vd less than 0, Vg less than 0, and Vs 0. For n-type, the electrons enter the channel through the source and leave the channel through the drain. This is the condition. And this is a structure is basically p-type T-fed, where source is n plus, body intrinsic, and drain p plus. So we say like p-i-n. While in case of n-type, this is source is p plus, so p-i-n. So this is basic difference between n-type and p-type tunnel filled with transistor structure. So when we talk about this operation of T-fed, so let's consider n-type T-fed. We have different states like ambipolar state, off state, on state. And for tunneling current, again we have ambipolar current, off current, and on state current. So for off state current at Vg 0, generally we say off state current and on state current. Suppose at a certain gate voltage, we have on state current and ambipolar. Suppose at some negative gate voltage, we have ambipolar current. So if you see, there is in this case, this is like PIN structure where VGS is 0, VDS is positive. In this case, we can say there is no tunneling through the barrier. But in case of VGS negative and VDS positive, we can say there is hole tunnels, and in case of VGS positive and VDS positive, electron tunnels. So this is the basic difference. So for MB polarity, and this is for our I on. So, and this is for I off, we can say this is, there is no tunneling. So off state current, this is derived from energy band diagram. How it looks like, how we can derive these currents respect to our energy band diagram. So now this is a simple double gate tunnel filled with a transistor. We have top and bottom gates. And when we say that, okay, how it looks like in the actual plot. So if you see for this, for zero gate voltage, if you see roughly, there is a very less, we can say there is no conduction, okay, from source to channel side. While in case of VDS 0.5 volt, if you see the band bending is too much, and source to channel side there is, because band bending is too much, so electrons can easily tunnel in this region. That's why we see the concentration is dark here. While in case of less ion current, so this concentration is very small, because the band bending, you can say it is less compared to this particular case. While in case of off state, or we go ambipolarity side, so drain to channel side, there will be slightly conduction. We can say, so this particular concentration region is showing the behavior of this particular current, negative current. So we thought that, okay, different kind of tunnel phase structures are there, which particular device we can design and use for analog array of circuit applications. So there were several challenges in tunnel filled with a transistor, like ambipolarity was the one thing. And so to focus on that part, what we have used in the same device, like pin gated structure, we have used metal 1, 2, and 3 kind of a structure. And the if you see here, metal 1 and metal 3 is having 4 electron volt, and metal 2 is having 4.6 electron volt. So based on that, what we found that, okay, this ambipolarity, if you see, this is going roughly in 10 power minus 16 ampere per micrometer region. So by using this combination, we can say, okay, we can, on the drain channel side, we can reduce our overall current and negative gate voltages. And also CGS and CGD. CGS is roughly in 0.2 femtofarad, and CGD is again 0.6, 0.7 femtofarad. So this is very less, almost we can say it is negligible. And based on that, CGS and CGD, this FT is derived based on the transconductance divided by CGS plus CGD transconductance when we are going from cutoff to saturation, and this GM is high. So at the higher gate voltage, we are getting higher FT value. And then device efficiency, how much GM by ID current we can pass. So if you see from VGS, so this device efficiency is almost constant for this particular region, and transconductance into frequency product. So it is also high when we are going roughly for 1.2 gate voltage. So we can get a higher transconductance frequency product. So these are the some parameters which is used in the RF domain. So if these parameters are improved, we can say that okay, this kind of devices can be used for RF application areas. And there are several other structures which we need to focus. So like internal field effect transistor, we have focused with band gap engineering for RF application. The main motivation for this one was to suppress the ambipolarity using wide band gap engineering concept, so that it maintains the digital circuitry operation similar to edge case in MOSFET. And it improves the on state, reduces the off state. So overall, we can say analog RF and linearity parameter we can get improved compared to conventional architecture or MOSFET case. So here, if we can say gate length, we have roughly 50 nanometer gate work function. These are the parameters which is used to design with band gap engineering. So what we did, so we have like a PIN conventional structure which was already present. So what we do, so just we have introduced material one and material two in drain and source side. So and suppose this is our n plus kind of structure. Now then, but we, to make it like a pin gated structure to work like a T-FET, what we did, so this we have made this structure like this was same n plus, then we have made it from n plus to I, and then we have moved n plus to I, and then I to P, so P plus. So P plus, I, n plus, then it become like pin gated structure. So how we made this from n plus to I and I to P plus, so first we have used some metal work function to change this n plus to I, and then basically we have applied a negative gate voltage polarity gate so that I can be changed to a P plus structure so that it can stretch the band on the above side so that it can form P plus I and n plus kind of a structure. So here basically the definition is first what we have done, control gate we have on the gate, and we have polarity gate. First, the work function of 2.72 electron volt is considered for controlling gate, and PG polarity gate to convert the layer which is beneath the control and polarity gate to make it intrinsic type in nature. And then we have further applied -1.2 volt at the polarity gate terminal to induce a P plus region from the intrinsic region so that the whole structure looks like P plus IN plus kind of a structure, so that it can work like a conventional T-FET architecture. So in different material combination, we have used silicon, germanium, gallium arsenide, germanium. And so in all these five combination, what we found that this particular green one gives better performance compared to all other combinations. This work we have published in IEEE Transaction in 2017. So here, if you see for this blue one basically denotes gallium arsenide based, germanium based structure. So gallium arsenide we have used on the drain side, which reduces the ambipolarity in the negative side, while germanium is used, low band gap material is used in the source side, which improves the on state current. So overall, IN by IF, we can say it improved compared to other cases. While GM is nothing but transconductance, if you see, which is going from cutoff to saturation. So at the peak, it is having the transconductance of roughly 1 millisiemen. And then from saturation to again triode, the due to mobility degradation, its transconductance is slightly reducing. But yeah, it is having transconductance which can be used for analog application area. So in other performance parameter, the CGS and CGD, so which is roughly in 0.4, 0.5 femtofarad and 2 femtofarad, 3 femtofarad range we have found. And this we know that the CGS and CGD, this is treated as a parasitic capacitances, and this CGD in case of 3 phase is roughly larger than the CGS, because this is also coming from feedback side. So we can consider that this value will be slightly higher. But yeah, almost with respect to 0.4, this is like 4 femtofarad, so 10 times it is higher. So, but yeah, this is not too much compared to MOSFET case. Yeah, this FT and FMAX also used in analog. This is used in analog application. This is used in RF application, where this is called as a cutoff frequency, while this FMAX is called a maximum frequency of oscillation. This is derived from this formula, and FT derived from this formula. So where we have CGS, CGD less, and GM high, there we can get FT high. So here we are getting GM high, so that's why FT cutoff frequency is high in this particular voltage region. And for linearity, basically, why linearity is important when we talk about RF figure of merits. So linearity is also one of the crucial parameter with other parameter like input matching, gain, noise, and power. So this has some foundation or some trade-off with other parameters. So where we need to focus, suppose we want to pass our main signal, so there are possibility that noise can go with main signal it can create some at the output side, it can create some interferer. So that will create some issue at the output side in form of noise. So we need to take, so how we can address these things. So if we see from this plot, we have different transconductance, GM1, GM2, GM3. So this third order, basically, it is denoting that, okay, if this third order product, roughly we are biasing on certain gate voltage, and then if we are biasing the device on certain gate voltage, where our GM3 is very small, then we can say that we are avoiding our intermodulation component, which is basically generated when interferers are amplified with main signal. So these are the transconductance parameter GM2, GM3. This is third derivative of drain current with respect to VGS. So once we derivate this one, so we see here that, okay, on certain gate voltage, so suppose around 0.82 voltage, where this it is crossing the zero axis. So on that, if we bias our device, then we get high linearity, which is nothing but second order input intercept voltage. So this denotes that, okay, here if we bias our device, then we will get good linearity. So how we can realize from device to circuit side? This question comes into everyone's mind who is working in device side. So what we need to do, we need to extract RF parameter as per Y parameter methodology. So this is like in different device TCAD tools are present, like in Silvaco and Centaurus, where we can extract these parameters CGS, CGD, RGD, and tau and GM. So based on that, we can build this small signal model. And once we have built this one, then we can import this model into a circuit simulator, like Cadence or Agilent ADS. We can import this particular model, and then we can use in circuit applications. So before that, we need to verify that, okay, this model is exactly showing the same behavior with respect to device behavior. So if you see here, this Y parameter, Y11, Y12, Y21, 22. So this is having solid and model one. So it is almost showing imaginary and real component, almost matching. It denotes that, okay, we can go with this model for circuit application. So this justified. And these are the basic equations for calculating these parameters based on the y1, y12, y21, and y22. So based on the real and imaginary component, we can calculate after equating real and imaginary part. We can calculate these parameters of this model. So once we have extracted these parameters, then basically we can import this in the any circuit tool, and then we can use in amplifier, we can use in any digital logic or in any RF circuit applications, and then we can point, okay, that how much its behavior looks like with conventional circuit architecture, like with MOSFET case. So when we talk about this device to circuit realization, there are some other techniques when we go purely for digital side. So how we do, this is the basically flow chart. So we have device label simulation first we need to do, then device label behavior we need to verify using TCAD tool. And then we need to build up 2D lookup table. And this table should have IDS versus VGS characteristic on different VDS, CGS versus VGS. CGD versus VGS characteristic on different VDS. Sorry, this is a typo. And realize a model for circuit application. Basically, this is the model. From gate to source we have cap, gate to drain we have cap, and drain to source we have drain to source current. So we need to prepare this table, so which is having VDS, VGS, IDS, CGS, and this QS, CGD, and QD, these we need to define based on the CB relationship, and then these we need to call in a very log format, and then we need to test in circuit level. So generally, we can define these relationships in very log format, how it looks like with respect to these current equations. So if you see, based on the model, we have validated, okay, that this, how the symbol, if you see, this is very log and this is TCAD, how this NMOS and PMOS looks like, the current behavior, output characteristic, which seems matching with the existing TCAD one. So which justified that, okay, we can go to use for digital circuit side. So here for inverter case, just we have implemented this one based on this very log model, where we have used p-type TFET, n-type TFET, and then we have sorted the gate and we have just checked the output. And in this case, if you see noise margin high, how it is calculated, just we have taken a output versus input characteristic, and then we have superimposed the inverse transfer characteristic, inverse output versus input characteristic on the same plot, and then we have checked that, okay, if we can fit maximum square in this particular region in top and bottom portion. So in the top portion, if you see this noise margin high, which is nothing but this Y height, and this is noise margin high, which is calculated based on the VOH minus VIH, and noise margin low, which is the smallest one, smallest square, which is denoting VIL minus VIL. So how much noise margin high and noise margin low we have, that we can calculate. So based on that, if we compare that, okay, for inverter characteristic, how much high to low propagation delay, low to high, this propagation delay, rise time, fall time, noise margin high, if we have. So this is just compared with respect to existing structure. And this structure which we have used band gap on, so we see that there are slight improvement compared to this digital performance parameter. So this is one thing for future. So suppose we want to go for high linearity application area, then we can use multi-gate devices. So in this reference, basically it is denoted for MOSFET case. But if you want to go for a high linearity application area, just if we can change this particular device to some other kind, like junctionless or TFET kind of structure, and then we can test this 1 dB compression point, which is a figure of merit for linearity. So it has like potential that, okay, if you replace this MOSFET structure with some other device, then definitely we have possibility to use TFET or junction layers for high linearity application. So from this waveform, if you see 1 dB compression point, which is denoting that, okay, after this particular point, we cannot get gain. So it means it is saturated and we have certain limit. We cannot cross that boundary of gate voltage. Otherwise, we will not be getting increasing gain. So 1 dB compression point, if we see from -29 to -22, so roughly from single metal double gate to triple metal double gate structure, which is, it is denoting that, okay, it is improving. So in negative term means when we are going from -29 to -22, roughly in terms of milliwatt power, so it is increasing. So this value denotes that it has high linearity, -22.87 dBm. It has high linearity for this triple metal double gate kind of a structure. So till now, no one has tested this one to replace this MOSFET to junctionless or tunnel filled if a transistor based structure. So this has like a, for future, we can try this one and then we can check how linearity looks like. So this linearity defined in terms of ratio of GM1 by GM3. If GM3 we can nullify and GM1 slightly we can improve. So overall 1 dB compression point we can improve. So this is the one future thing. And finally, we see that, okay, this band gap has potential. This our group has tested on tunnel filled if a transistor. We saw that it improves the on state and it suppresses the ambipolar current for analog and RF circuit side. And it can also be extended in multi-gate tunnel filled if a architecture, like in gate all around structure, to improve overall current and linearity parameters. And this can also be improved using pocket doping techniques. And here, one new thing is that polarity control, which we have added on the drain side to make from N plus 2i, P plus type, that we can realize in for experimental as well as for device modeling or circuit part. And apart from this, we can also use these circuit, these devices in other circuit application areas, like in biosensor circuits, analog and RF circuits, and in memory application areas. So these devices has potential. That's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The session is now open for any queries from audience side. Participants, if you have any questions, please put into the comment box. You can directly ask to the respected speaker.
Is there any question in the chat window?
So, sir, I think there is no questions. From audience side. Yeah, okay. One question is from Harinder Singh, is that please clear the ambipolar current and in current, on current.
Okay. So when this ambipolarity, this particular phenomena comes into digital side, so then we apply some gate voltage in negative side, less than zero voltage. Roughly we get some current, which is nothing but, suppose for TFET case, we can say that it arises due to channel drain phenomena. So that generates ambipolar current. And if that current is something, so it can impact when the device switches from on to off state in digital side, so it can impact. And on state current is when we are applying some gate voltage. For n-type, suppose tunnel filled if a transistor, we apply some positive gate voltage. it has some current, so that is when it is in conduction mode. Okay, so this is the basic difference between ambipolar and on state current.
Okay, sir. Is there any other query from audience side?
Yeah, there is one more question I can see. Please explain band gap engineering for device structure. So band gap engineering is nothing but we are doing some engineering in drain side or in source side. So we can add some band gap materials, like which band gap materials we need to introduce, that we need to understand. So suppose on the drain side, if you use higher band gap materials, then definitely we will get some improvement in off state or ambipolar side. And if you use low band gap material, we can engineer in source side, then definitely we can generate more charge carriers in the source side. Then this is the like a simple thing. Okay, which combination we want to use, what is the intention? Just intention is to improve the performance overall design matrix. Okay, so this is we can use in the drain side or the source side.
One more question is there in comment box, sir. It's please explain how tunneling happens in the junctionless field effect transistor. Hello, is it audible?
I guess he lost his connection again.
Sunil sir, is it audible?
Let me call him.
We will wait for few minutes.
Hello.
Yes sir.
Sorry, actually there was some network issue at my side.
Okay, no problem, sir. One basic question is being asked from one of the participants is how tunneling happens in the junctionless field effect transistors.
Okay, this is good question. So we have n plus kind of a structure, right, in junctionless. And then how we can make junctionless T fade? First we need to convert it into n plus IP plus type structure, and then we can say, okay, this junctionless is converted to n plus IP plus. And then we can say from channel, between channel and source, there is a this band bending. This is similar to like a pin gated structure of TFET, and in that case only we can say that there will be this tunneling will happen. So in normal case there will not be this tunneling in junctionless, but yeah, first we need to convert it like a TFET kind of a structure.
Okay, so with this, let's thank to our eminent speaker, Dr. Sunil Pandey sir, for his valuable time and his basic lecture on the depletion and inversion MOSFET, starting from the basic introduction to the basic devices to the deep insights of emerging field effect transistors like junctionless transistors and tunnel field effect transistors. He has also described the various strategies, modeling, and its applications. So I, on behalf of the organizing team, I am thanking to Dr. Sunil Pandey, sir, for his valuable time, for his
thank you, sir. Thank
effort
you. Thank you.
To make this event successful. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
And this is the announcement. Now we are end of the session, and we will resume the session at 2 p.m. with the new speaker, and followed by that lecture, we will continue our hands-on session. So we will resume our session at 2 p.m. and I request all participants to be present in time. Thank you, all of you.
I can drop, right, sir?
Yes, sir.
I can drop now. Yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.